sine x over x a limit go as x goes to 0 is actually a very important limit. This is one we want to use start using as an identity. So this sine x over x, if we compare what sine x is, again, sine x would be the vertical height of this line in the unit circle, and x would represent the arc length in the circle. So the angle x is actually really an arc length, and that's why we use radians, because the radians actually represent lengths along the arc. So if we were to do this limit as sine x over x as x goes to 0, what's happening is that angle gets smaller and smaller and smaller, and that relative height compared to the arc starts becoming looking more and more the same. So as we narrow that angle, this curved line looks more and more straight, and it starts to mimic this straight line here. So the sine x over x ratio as x goes to 0 tends to be that sine x length, and the x length starts looking the same, so the ratio is equal to 1. And if we graph this, we also get the same thing. That sine of pi is, I think, 0, okay? Negative pi is 0. And the graph, sine values are going to be negative and then positive 4. So it's going to look, oh, what's it going to look like? Okay, we should graph this. But anyways, it's going to have some function that looks kind of like this, right? And it's going to end up being equal to 1 at this point. Okay, so we can actually, let's actually figure this out. So the graph of this is going to be 0, 0 and 0 here. As x equals pi over 2, sine is going to be equal to 1 divided by positive pi over 2. It's going to be something around here. Okay, divided by, it's going to be equal to positive 1. Sine of negative pi over 2 is going to be negative 1 divided by pi over 2. So maybe somewhere around here. Okay, actually it's going to be a little bit higher, I think. 1 divided by 1.57. Okay, so this graph is going to come up, and then it's going to approach 1 as we go to 0. Okay, so this is our sine x over x ratio. Geometrically, we can define it like this. If we graph it, it's going to look like this. Okay, and this is actually a very important limit, and we want to know this limit as an identity. So if you can remember this one, this is great. Okay, so again, when we do those limits, local limits, okay, this is local behavior here, but when we do limits at infinity, we can use endpoint behavior, and we can use this relative strength of functions, okay? Weak over strong or strong over weak. As long as it's going to infinity, we can use this. So it's good for this, but we cannot use this argument for local behavior, okay? So we cannot use it for local behavior, only for endpoint behavior. But this is very useful, and understanding this power of function is very important as we do more and more calculus. So at this point, we have developed a few strategies. So graphing, which is our go-to if we can. Okay, graphs are the easiest way to do limits. In fact, even when you do algebraic limits, you can check them on graphs. We can do tabular limits. Okay, we have some algebraic strategies now, simplification. We have some geometric strategies as well. And with these algebraic strategies, we have to make sure that we have these graphs in mind, because we have to worry, there's a few things we have to worry about, right? Which side of zero are we dividing by when we divide by zero? Okay, and when we look at these limits, we also have to worry about one-sided limits versus two-sided limits. So there's all these factors now that we are having to consider.